Hello students. So today we are going to discuss the second part of the first chapter, matter. Today we are going to discuss kinetic theory of matter and conservation of mass. We have already discussed so far interconversion of states of matter and what causes the difference in states. So let us begin our today's topic, which is first kinetic theory of matter. See, kinetic theory of matter explains the behavior of three states of matter, which are solid, liquid, and gas. It is summarized below. As you can see, all matter is made up of many tiny particles, which are known as molecules. So molecules are very tiny particles which made matter. In the solid state, particles are rigidly held. They are fixedly held in positions about which they can only vibrate. They cannot leave their position. They can only vibrate. In the liquid state, particles are in continuous motion but are not completely separated from each other. When they are in motion, they collide with each other. So we can say that they are not at rest. On the other hand, they are always in continuous motion. Then in gaseous state, the particles are in continuous random motion, almost independent. They are not dependent on another particle. They move continuously, independent of each other, and randomly in every possible direction. The particle in gas travel much longer distance than in liquid before they collide with other particles or with the walls of the vessel, because in gas, lot of intermolecular space is already present, so they don't collide much because the particles are present at large distance from each other. The collision of particles with the walls of vessel give rise to pressure of gas. When the particles of gas they collide with the walls of vessels, then pressure of gas is generated. So these are the few postulates of kinetic theory of matter. So you should remember them. Now coming back to the next one. The particle possess some energy due to their motion. So when the particles are in continuous motion, they have some energy. That energy is known as kinetic energy. The kinetic energy which is possessed is dependent on temperature. So when temperature is increased, kinetic energy also increases. And when temperature is decreased, kinetic energy also decreases. So we can say that kinetic energy is highly dependent on temperature. On increasing the temperature, kinetic energy increase itself, and on decreasing the temperature or on lowering the temperature, kinetic energy is lowered. So these are the few six postulates of kinetic theory of matter, which explains the behavior of all the three states of matter, which are solid, liquid, and gas. Then, how kinetic theory explains interconversion of states of matter? That is our next topic. How kinetic theory explains the interconversion of states of matter? Interconversion of states of matter, already we have discussed that when the change in states takes place from solid to liquid or liquid to gas, then it is known as interconversion of states of matter. So in this topic, we are going to deal with solid liquid interconversion and solid to liquid and liquid to solid, both the types of interconversion. So first is solid to liquid interconversion. The particle constituting a solid only vibrate about their mean positions. As a solid is heated, the kinetic energy of the particle increases with rising temperature. The particles vibrate more and more vigorously till they move away from their fixed positions at a particular temperature, which is known as melting point of a solid, and hence a solid becomes liquid at its melting point. So, what important definition is of melting point? It is a fixed temperature at which a solid changes to liquid state. So, melting point is that fixed temperature at which solid changes to liquid state. The next is liquid to solid interconversion. As liquid is cooled, the kinetic energy of the particle decreases. I told you earlier that kinetic energy is dependent on temperature. on increase in temperature, the kinetic energy increases, and on decreasing the temperature, kinetic energy decreases. So particles move shorter and shorter as the temperature is decreased. Now particle does not possess as much energy as they had earlier. So what will happen? They will try to now come closer to each other, and hence the distance will be shorter and shorter as the temperature is lower. Means the particles now will come closer to each other as the temperature is decreased. At freezing point, a particular point which is called freezing point, the translatory motion, that is the motion from one point to another, will stop, will cease. Ceases means it stops, and the particles get rigidly fixed. Now they start becoming fixed, and hence this is how a liquid changes to solid. However, the particle in solid continue to vibrate. Although I am saying that the temperature is decreasing, now the particles will come closer to each other, but they are not becoming stationary. They will not be stationary. They will still be in vibrations even if they are very close to each other. So the particles in solid continue to vibrate about their mean positions. So vibration is always there in the particles, no matter in which state they are. If the temperature is more, then they will vibrate more vigorously, and if the temperature is less, then they will vibrate a little less, but vibration will always be there. Now next is liquid to gas interconversion. First is liquid to gas itself. The particles in liquid are in continuous motion, okay, during which they collide among themselves. If they collide strongly, then some particles may overcome the attractive force and escape. So depending upon the type of collision the particles are facing, if the collision is strong enough, then the particles may escape. A liquid evaporates in this manner, and hence evaporation takes place as the temperature is raised. Now if the temperature is increased, kinetic energy of the particle increases. Again, I told you that temperature, with increase in temperature, kinetic energy increases, and the particles collide now more strongly. This leads to faster evaporation, since earlier the collision was taking place. Now more number of collisions will take place in a particular time. Earlier in evaporation, less number of collisions were taking place, but now more number of collisions will take place at a particular limit, particular time period. So this leads to faster evaporation of liquid. At the boiling point, so this is again important, the temperature, fixed temperature is boiling point. At boiling point, the kinetic energy of the particle becomes so great that all the particles try to escape now. Now at the boiling point of the liquid, kinetic energy of the particle will become great, that the particles tends to escape. Thus at boiling point, the entire liquid may turn into vapor. So at boiling point, what happens? The whole liquid will change to vapor. The entire liquid may change to vapor state. So this is liquid to gas interconversion. Next is gas to liquid interconversion. Now in gaseous state, the particles move very fast, independent of each other. As we know that in gaseous state, the particles are very far away from each other. They may form bigger lumps or clusters, and the gas may condense, and hence then gas may condense into liquid. Now the conditions of change of state differ from substance to substance. A liquid freezing at 0 degree and boiling at 100 degree Celsius is water, but it is not the condition that all the liquids will boil at 100 degree and all the liquids will freeze at 0 degree. This specific temperature of 0 degree and 100 degree is only for water. One boiling at 78 degrees ethanol. Ethanol's boiling point is 78 degree. In fact, melting and boiling points are characteristic of a substance, and you can identify the substance by determining these points. So all the substance have characteristic boiling point, characteristic freezing point. And if we know the characteristic freezing and boiling point, we can identify the unknown substances. If some unknown substances are given to you and you have asked to identify them, then we can determine their boiling point and melting point, freezing point and melting point, or boiling point. And hence we can easily determine which substance is present or which we have to identify. In other words, the condition of change of substance differ from state to state. This is because intermolecular force and intermolecular space differ from one substance to another substance. So no matter that we have a solid or we have two solids, both are in solid state, but still there may be some variation in their intermolecular space or intermolecular force, and because of which same state substances also have different boiling and freezing points. Liquid water is also liquid, alcohol is also liquid, but still both of them have different boiling point because of their intermolecular space and intermolecular force. So the conditions of change of state differ from substance to substance. Now next we have the conversion of mass. You know that only rearrangement of atoms or molecules takes place when a change occurs. And as the atoms or molecules of substance have fixed masses, the total mass of the substance in a change should always same. So this is only the law of conservation of mass, which states, which was given by Lavoisier in 18th century, and which says that matter can neither be created nor be changed from one form to another, and the total mass of the substance before and after the change remains the same. So matter, we cannot create a matter, neither we can destroy, and the change and the mass before and after the reaction remains same. The law of conservation of mass is true for physical as well as chemical changes. So we can say that the total mass of the substances before and after the change is always same. So when we see at physical changes, it is easily understood that there is no change in mass of a substance when it undergoes a physical change. For example, the mass of an electric bulb does not change after it remains lighted for some time because it is a physical change. Similarly, a given mass of ice on melting gives the same mass of water because it is a physical change, and a given mass of water on boiling gives the same mass of water vapor again because it is a physical change. So in physical changes, there is no change in mass and before and after the reaction. So similarly, similar things happens in chemical change also. According to the law of conservation of mass, in a chemical change, the sum of masses of reactant is same as that of product. So we must look at total mass of substance before and after the reaction, which is always the same. Mass of reactant is always equal to mass of product. So burning of piece of paper, it looks like there is loss of mass, but that is not the case. In fact, while burning the paper, it takes up oxygen from the air and forms some ash plus carbon dioxide plus water vapor. So we have to see whether or not the mass of paper and oxygen taken from the air is equal to that of ash plus carbon dioxide and water vapor. So when we undertook a detailed experiment and we measured their masses, then it came out to be that mass of paper plus oxygen was equal to mass of ash plus carbon dioxide plus water vapor. So we can easily verify this law with the help of some simple experiments, but the mass before and after the reaction remains same. We have to take in consideration the amount of air being consumed for burning. Next experiment was a reaction took place between sodium sulfate and barium chloride. And this is an example of precipitation also. Precipitate is formed. So we have taken a bottle and a solution of barium chloride in a conical flask. Some sodium sulfate solution is taken in another flask. But with the help of dropper, we have to pour sodium sulfate solution drop by drop so that they don't come in contact altogether. Drop by drop, we are pouring it. We close the mouth of the flask with the cork and we weigh it before and after the reaction. Now you tilt the flask and swirl, means rotate it slowly. A white precipitate is formed and we have to leave the flask for some time and weigh it again. Then we will find that there is no change in weight of flask. So before the experiment and after the experiment, if we took the weight, it came out to be same. Although there was a formation of precipitate, but again, because the law of conservation of mass is followed by both physical and chemical changes, hence we can say that law of conservation of mass is followed. So what is law of conservation of mass? Matter can neither be created nor be destroyed, but can be changed from one form to another, and the total mass of the substances before and after the change remains the same. this law of conservation of mass is true for physical as well as chemical changes. You should remember this. No matter what type of change is taking place, law of conservation of mass will always be followed. It will never be neglected, both for physical as well as chemical change. Although though both the changes are different from each other, physical change and chemical change are different from one another, but both of them follows law of conservation of mass. Mass of reactant is always equal to the mass of product. There is no loss in mass. There is no, you, because we cannot create a matter or we cannot destroy the matter. We can only transform it from one form to another, and in which the mass remains unchanged. So in this chapter, with this we finished chapter number 1. So I hope everybody will watch the video and read the book also. In the book, whatever is written that you read, and exercises also we will discuss in the class. Thank you.